Okay, good to go, everybody. Just like what we do after a game, we digest it and look at it from every angle. A couple things stood out. Obviously, still pleased. Found a way to win the game. I thought it was competitive. Credit to Florida Atlantic. They pushed us in a lot of different ways. Schematically, physically, had some good players, contested and came down to the end. And like I said, we finished really, really well. I thought the crowd, again, was awesome. Impacted the thing. Really appreciate everyone's energy and coming out, especially that student section. You know, on our end, definitely looking to clean some things up offensively. I'll start there. It's 11-man football, and we had too many times where whether just missed assignment, missed identification, and so we're not IDing the front correctly, and we got too many, free hitters in the run game. Got to find ways to be more efficient there. In the pass game, so much is about detail. I did think the protection, for the most part, showed up pretty well. I thought, we had time to make throws. The pocket was clean a lot of the time. Not all, but a lot of it. So I was pleased with that part. And then it comes down to, taking care of the ball in red zone efficiency. We just wasn't where we need to be, and we got to take a step there, and excited about the opportunity to kind of dive in and improve. Defensively, a lot to like. We were on the same page. Communication throughout the game was solid. Thought they played with great effort, running the ball, tackling for our first game. A lot of good tackling, not a bunch of missed tackles. Guys playing with leverage. It just comes down to we have to be able to finish plays with greater awareness, just smarter the penalty side. And again, it's first games and guys are flying around, but we got to do it at a higher level. I think we gave them 6 free first downs, 9, maybe 9 penalties on defense, which is it's going to get us beat. Special teams wise, that pin punt changed the game. Eckley gets it down. We cover it really well. Gets the ball on the one, turns into a safety, turns into a great field position. So that was awesome to see. In general, though, I think our coverage can get cleaned up. I think we got exposed. I know we had a long return that we got a penalty on, but we're not in great lanes. We got to clean up our coverage. We can get exposed there. So that'll be a point of emphasis kind of this week in practice. I've told you guys on the injury side, we're not going to day in and day out be talking about a ton, but we did have a couple of guys go down that'll be longer term injuries. Alante Brown will be, hopeful to maybe November coming back. Khalil Majeed, doubtful to come back. Dylan Tatum, at least a couple of months, if not for the year. So those three guys, which is a blow. I mean, all three of them contributing, playing awesome, feel really bad for them, but they are longer term injuries and always want to just be up front with that part. Transitioning into game two and starting Big Ten play, we're excited about it. Got to go on the road and play a really good opponent. These guys have been multiple bowl games the last few years. They got talent on both sides of the ball. They scored a bunch in week one. And so Coach Locksley got a bunch of respect. This guy, he knows how to coach football, and that roster's got a lot of good players. And so we've got our work cut out for us coming this Saturday. With that, I'll take some questions.
Hey, Jonathan, Ron here. Does it help at all when your game two is a Big Ten game on the road? I mean, versus staying at home playing like an right. FCS opponent, as far as increasing the sense of urgency for that improvement?
Right. Yeah. It adds to the challenge. I think it's, the schedule is what it is. I think from game one to game two, we were going to have some serious sense of urgency to get better after game one. We did learn a bunch about this team. First experience of this team in all three phases, individual players, we learned a bunch. Now kind of where they're at, what they need to take a step on. So that approach I don't think would have changed at all. It just does. You get a big-time opponent that's got a bunch of good players, and it's a real challenge on the road.
Staying with that, open up Big Ten play on the road. Can you share a little bit about the differences and the similarities in preparation, even the nuances when you have to get a team and go on a road and also kind of come together as one?
Yeah, one of the differences on the road, obviously, you're going to go through the travel part, which will be the first time for us, right? So the day before is going to be different than it was last week. Locker rooms, crowd noise, kind of going on our own. We do expect to see some Spartans out there and that part of the country, but it's not going to be like it was Friday night in a packed house with the energy you're getting from our stadium crowd. It's going to be different.
So obviously, those two injuries with Dylan and Khalil in the secondary, you mentioned that being a big blow. How do you kind of progress forward and kind of with Malik coming back too, I mean, obviously yeah. suspended, how much of a difference does he make? Not suspended, he was ejected. Mm-hmm. But how much of a difference does he make? And I mean, keeping those guys healthy is
big. Yeah, we're going to need to. I mean, because that's a position that you need to have multiple bodies to play. Especially you think about DT's in, the flexibility, he can play nickel, he can play safety, shoot, he can play some corner a little bit last year, so he had some position flexibility that now we don't have. So yeah, getting Malik back, huge. Nakai obviously had a nice game, and we've got some, you know, answers, but Nate's always going to be the next man up. This game's a physical game, and different positions are going to take a blow or two, and we got to have the next guy to step in.
Jonathan, the last 2 years, I think your Oregon State teams averaged 5.6 penalties a game, something like that, less than 60 yards. As you look back now, having analyzed it, what caused that and the late hits on some of the slides? How do you coach that?
Yeah, we got to do a better job coaching it. And again, it's not just Michigan State. I pulled a couple of clips, showed the team on Sunday that's across the country that this showed up in game one. And so we've got to be able to, you know, we're not going to slow down in how we play on defense, but we got to have some awareness around the quarterback, around the sideline, understand the rule, and make some tweaks to maybe how we approach the quarterback in regards to low versus high. So that'll be some emphasis this week.
Jonathan, over here, you mentioned that you liked the protection. I'm wondering what you saw from running lanes created and your assessment of the two backs.
Run game wasn't good enough. Just the efficiency of it. You know, we had the long run on the one, but we've got to identify it correctly to start, more consistently correctly. And then we got to get some movement. And so we've got to create some more space for those guys to go. I did think Kayron carried the ball pretty well, did some good stuff. Nate did some good stuff when there was more to run through. At some times we're gonna have that. You know, our style of play, they're gonna load the box at times, and you know, there's gonna be some 2 yard runs, 3 yard runs. We just had way too many of them. We need to get more in the 6-8, and it starts with identification and some movement up front.
You had a number of guys on defense that created pressure, and I'm wondering anybody when you watched it back that really stood out that you thought, boy, this was nice.
Ken Talley. I mean, this guy loved it. And we said we were going to play a lot of guys, but he wasn't going to get a ton of snaps. And the way the thing went, he did end up impacting the game in the second half in particular. That guy showed up in a huge way when it was critical times. You know, they're moving the ball in the red zone. He gets a huge sack on third down, obviously ends the game on the fourth down. It was an incompletion, but he created the pressure. So was pleased with him along with others up front.
Jonathan, I noticed your first walk to the stadium and your first run out of the tunnel, you let the players take the lead. You were a little further back in both of those settings. I wonder if you could talk about the mindset behind that.
Yeah, we want to be player-led around here. I actually spoke to the team, giving them the heads up. That's how, we're, you know, because we walk through all the pregame and how this takes place. I also love the fact that the strength coach, who spends the most time with them, is up in front of that thing. Those guys have put the summer hours, the sweat that goes into it. So that's the logic a little bit. We're going to be player-led, let these guys go and running out. Me running first, I'm the slowest one running out there, and so I don't think that helps things either.
Obviously, Coach, Aiden was frustrated with his performance since Friday night. What have you seen from him in terms of his attitude, his mood? Has he flushed it? Has he moved on?
I think he's a competitive kid, and it was frustrating for him. And I thought, you know, we practiced lightly yesterday, and he was bouncing around. Understands that we got to grow, we got to learn, and he's all about doing that. He's aware too; it's not just all on him. But he's got some plays that he can make. I thought he got hit pretty good on one. We got a crosser wide open. He gets hit. We don't complete the ball. He bounced back up and responded. Bounced back from that. I expect him to bounce back this week.
Just wondering, what was your first experience running into that stadium? You talked about the energy in general, but what do you remember about entering that stadium for the first time? Anything strike you?
Well, I've always liked Thunderstruck. I mean, even growing up, so that thing playing and going, smoke, energy, the band's right there. It was fun.
I'm also wondering, I know you can't change the rule in midseason and you got to coach for it, but in your opinion, does that rule in the offseason need to be revisited, because defensive players are in midair and quarterbacks all over are sliding down, and you can't stop yourself, and your helmets are going to hit. Does that rule need to be revisited in your mind?
They could revisit it, look at it. Again, I'm not here to say it needs to get totally changed. It's a tough play. I mean, that immediate instance where he's going full speed to turning into defenseless, it's tough. And the reality, I do think proper way to tackle it oftentimes on ball carriers is to go low, cut their motor. We want to tackle their legs. Well, when you're doing that, and then all of a sudden immediately he goes down, you're going to run into some of these things. So it's a tough play. We got to continue to coach it and gain awareness from it, and our guys will. But I'm not here to say flat out the rule needs to be changed tomorrow.
Hey, Jonathan, you were talking before the season about depth of receiver and guys stepping up. Nobody was able to record it. Even 30 yards receiving. I don't know how often that happens in games you've coached, but yeah. I guess what are you looking from that group game 1 to 2 to really establish?
Details. Those guys, you know, they play a little bit more man coverage than what we saw last week. We got to be able to separate, but details on where I split, how far I go on my depth, I got to be able to separate man coverage with some stair step techniques and things like that. I'm confident in that group. You know, again, week 1 to week 2 to week 3, we got to continually improve. We've got some talent in that room, and we got to, you know, take a step in our pass game.
Maryland presents different challenges than FAU does offensively, especially with the way that they can move the ball, you know, through the air. Just what are you looking for from your defense to be able to, I guess, present this new challenge?
Yeah, it is a challenge because they've got talent outside that can make you miss. Quarterback with a strong arm who's a willing runner. I mean, Coach Lux has done it at a high level on that offensive side for a long time. So it's a serious challenge, different than week 1, right? I mean, just in the passing game, which is, you know, week in and week out of college football, you're going to have some different challenges, but they present a serious one on that side.
Getting on the road for the first time, too, I guess, how do you approach it with the guys with the longer extended period here between games? And just the impact that you guys need to make right now with a Big Ten game right out of the chute here.
Yeah, you know, so you got to be able to start fast. You know, our routine on the week, whether we're on home or away, doesn't change a ton. We'll be back to our practice starting tomorrow. Those three practices will be very similar. Now, we might pump in a little crowd noise for the offense versus the defense like we did when we were playing at home. Our approach on Fridays before we travel, we try to get some work done meetings-wise and things before we get on the airplane, and then try to get a good night's rest and on the routine. Start Big Ten play, again, our approach can't totally change, and it really won't. Big Ten game or this opponent, that type of thing, we're sticking to a process and looking forward to getting another opportunity.
Jonathan, I'm wondering, you talked about Maryland's offense a little bit. They didn't, I don't know if it was a shutout, maybe they allowed one, but just defensively, what did you notice from those guys?
They return a bunch of players that had played last year. I think the veteran defensive front. They got a couple of safeties that can run and make plays, that transfer at corner. They got some challenges there. And they won handily last week. I think they gave up 7. And so that it's a good outfit.
Is it a deal where you have to prepare for both quarterbacks? I know both played. The one got hit, though. But is it a deal where this week you just had to be ready for both?
Yeah, you got to kind of be ready, for both. Again, both of them have skill set to be able to run the ball and do some things. So we're counting on seeing both of them.
Just, I was wondering, like, your weekly prep. I know you got 3 Friday games this year, but typically you're off day, you come back on Saturday game, and you practice Sunday or and then Monday off. I was just wondering just what your thought process is behind that. Is it something you picked up from another?
Yeah, I've kind of always liked to, really emphasis on, we got to correct and improve. And so just taking the day on Sunday after the game to make an emphasis on getting things fixed right away. I'm a believer in, the off day for the player on Monday. Businesses are open, school, they can see a teacher, get a haircut, that kind of thing. Like the full day allowed for the coaches on the game planning side. And so we've been doing that for a while.
Just following up a little bit more, I guess, on details of the injuries, upper body, lower body, can you tell us what they sustained?
Yep. So Dylan and Khalid are lower body, and Alante is upper body.
Anything else, Coach? All right. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.